Welcome to Chandler in Focus. I'm Vice Mayor Kevin Hartke, and our topic of conversation today is Cup of Karma Cafe, located in our downtown library. This is not your ordinary coffee shop, as we're soon going to find out. And as I am known by my friends, I am a bit of a coffee snob, so I need to explore this little cafe a little better. But this cafe is actually referred to as a community cafe for a cause. And my guests today are Mona Lou Callery, and CEO of the National Advocacy and Training Network, and Judy Baker, the Senior Program Manager, also with the National Advocacy and Training Network. So welcome to our program today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're glad to have you here. Mona Lou, let's start with you. Tell us a little bit about yourself, as well as what the National Advocacy and Training Network is, please.
Well, the National Advocacy and Training Network is an Arizona-based nonprofit agency that we formed in 2002. It was professionals, advocates, survivors, and people working in the field who created this agency to end, and the bottom line is to end violence against women, children, and families.
So that's your mission, is to end domestic violence of in households, particularly women and children. And how does that relate to Cup of Karma Cafe? That's not your usual connection.
Well, Cup of Karma is our revenue-generating social venture project that we put under the National Advocacy and Training Network. Basically, the coffee shop does a lot more than make coffee, but we provide job training for women living in our housing programs, as well as high school teenagers in the community and community volunteers.
And how did you get involved with this program, and what is your background? Is there a bit of a connection that drew you to be involved with this particular organization?
Well, I'm a survivor of domestic violence myself, and it was more than 33 years ago. And even back then, noticing that some of the systems weren't exactly set up to provide sort of long-term safety. You know, a 30, 60, or 90, or 120-day stay in a shelter doesn't equip you with enough skills to be able to become self-sufficient and support your family. And I thought, well, let's put them together. We can own businesses, we can run businesses, as well as provide job training for the women and people in the community that we work with.
Was this your idea to start the cafe, or how did that get started?
It was. I've always thought about, you know, there has to be some business aspect attached to nonprofits to help them generate more income instead of constantly asking people for money, because that's what nonprofits, it's writing grants, it's asking people for donations all the time. And so my thoughts were to bring it all together and offer multiple problem solving skills with the, you know, in addition to providing shelter.
Very good. Judy, how about you? I understand we both have a northern connection and moved
yes,
to Chandler, the Arizona, about the same time. How did you get involved with this? And tell us a little bit about your background.
I got involved through the job training program. I was a resident in one of the houses that we have, that are the Seeds houses. And as a resident, I was able to take advantage of the job training program. And through that, I became the senior program manager.
So you used an acronym, SEEDS. And again, one of my missions in life is to never let an acronym go unexplained. So tell us what that means.
SEEDS stands for Support, Education, Empowerment, and Direction. And it is the transitional housing program that is run through NATN.
Okay. So with the housing components, obviously not looking for locations, is there housing locations beyond the immediate valley here, or is this a very much of a we're serving the needs here organization?
Well, we're serving the needs here. We have two homes in Chandler and two homes in Mesa, and they're just regular homes that you would never know or homes that is a shelter or transitional housing. And the difference with our SEEDS program is that women can live in these homes up to 2 years or however long it takes for them to get on their feet.
Well, very good. So let's talk about Cup of Karma Cafe in the downtown library. First of all, do you like coffee?
I love coffee.
We've got another affinity. So tell us how this relationship with our city came into being, and tell us what's available at the cafe.
Well, the city of Chandler has been a longtime supporter, financial supporter of our transitional housing. We were serving, different abused women and children within the city of Chandler before we even had a house here. So the library staff got to know that, some of the library staff got to know that we were running a coffee shop in Mesa, and they let us know that there was going to be a contract available, and they said that, you know, we should throw our name in the hat, and we did. We submitted a whole proposal along with a business plan, and we competed against some top dogs in the coffee business, and we won them out, and we got the contract, and we opened our doors within the Chandler Library on March 1st, 2014.
Very good, so a little more than a year. So apart from coffee, what else do you offer there?
We offer sandwiches, we have breakfast items, lunch items, we have snacks, we try to have a little healthy menu as well. We offer a lot of smoothies, fraps. What else, Judy?
Oh, the cappuccinos. And we've got some signature drinks that are exclusive to us, which, you know, are very, very popular.
All right, Judy, you got to tell me more. What's the most popular signature drink?
Well, the most popular signature drink, I think, is called a Luisa's Energy Slush.
Hmm.
And it's made with different flavors. You know, you can choose whatever flavors you want. It's got a vitamin B complex energizer in it, very healthy, and it's blended. It's an ice drink.
Mona Lou, how did you come up with the name Cup of Karma Cafe? Tell us the story.
Actually, that it was a mixture of myself and a former employee. Well, she used to volunteer, then she worked for us. And we were just throwing around names, and I think she came up with the Karma Cup or something like that, but we ended up calling it Cup of Karma, Community Cafe for a Cause. And we know it's long, but we need the community to know that it's more than a coffee shop.
So you like the alliteration in that title?
Yeah.
Oh, very good. So who works at the cafe? Obviously, from what you said previously, people that you are assisting to help get back on their feet and learn mm-hmm. some trades, and tell us specifically maybe a story about one of your employees and who benefits from the proceeds as well.
Well, of course, we're doing the on-the-job training, hands-on training to some of the women who live in our homes who don't necessarily have any good job skills. And it's a 3 to 4 month training program where they learn real specific skills, more than customer service, mm-hmm. but how to money management, inventory, entrepreneurial type jobs that they can move on from us. And in addition to them, we have high school teenagers. Some of them are doing just community volunteer work, or the high school requires them to get so many credits, but some of them stay on with us. And then, of course, community volunteers. We try to match a community volunteer with the women working at the shop to mentor them, to provide leadership skills, to be involved in their community. And all the proceeds from the coffee shop, of course, go back to support the operation costs of our homes and, of course, pay the bills for the coffee shop.
Very good. And the specific location is obviously in our downtown library. What are the hours of operation?
It's Monday through Wednesday. It's 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. It's the same hours as the library. Okay. Thursday through Saturday, it's 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And Sunday, it's 1 to 5.
And do you still operate in the in Mesa as well?
Oh, we do.
Very good.
It's a little different because it's not in a library, so we have open mic, live music, and different things like that as well.
And where is this store at?
1710 West Southern Ave.
1710 West Southern. So that would be about Alma School and Southern, or where would that be?
Between Alma School and Dobson.
Okay.
Right across from MCC football field.
Okay, I know where that is. Good location to draw in some of our MCC students.
Mm-hmm.
Probably get some people studying in there as well. So how has couple karma impacted women's lives? Can you tell us maybe a story?
Well, I mean, we have so many stories, and of course, I have one of them here, Judy.
Maybe Judy should tell her story.
Well, I came into the SEEDS program as a resident with a domestic violence history background, and I was there a couple of months. I hadn't worked in 5 years, and I didn't know what skills I had or if I could even hold a job at that time. And I was asked to work in the coffee shop, which I did. And it renewed my faith in myself that I did still have skills. And the fact that somebody else believed in me and what I could do made a tremendous difference in my life. And it was just the support and working with the public again. Gave me, you know, the encouragement and the self-esteem that I needed to continue.
And how long have you been involved with Couple Karma?
I've been involved since 2009.
2009.
Mm-hmm. Six years.
Is anyone been around longer than Judy in terms that has continued to be part of the program or helping build the program with you?
They are involved in. One of the things I feel is unique about all of our programs is some of the women who move into their own apartment after they leave us, get other jobs. We formed a resident advisory committee, we call it, and it's former residents who come together and give back to the program, whether they continue to volunteer at the coffee shop or they mentor new women coming into the house. They assist when we're doing a fundraiser or an event, and they help us with it. And all the policies and procedures of our programs are developed with them at the table, deciding what rules we should have in place for the women coming into our program.
Very good. Well, if you're watching our show, I am Vice Mayor Kevin Hartke, and our topic of Chandler in Focus today is the Cup of Karma Cafe, located in our downtown library. And I have with us today Mona Lou Callery, who is the CEO of the National Advocacy and Training Network, and Judy Baker, the Senior Program Manager, also with the National Advocacy and Training Network. And these two are women with a mission. They have been committed to helping women get out of the trap or the pit, so to say, of domestic violence and realizing that they not only have value, but they are more than survivors. So, and it's great again to have you at our program today.
Thank you.
So, Mona Lou, you mentioned, actually Judy mentioned a little bit about SEEDS earlier, the support, education, empowerment, and directions. What else would you add to what she shared with us?
You mean as far as some of the services we offer?
Sure, and how did this get started? Was this one of your, is this part of another network, or is this something that you had started?
It's all under the National Advocacy and Training Network. I mean, when we formed it, we thought big. So okay. That's why we said national. But the SEEDS component of it, the housing component, we provide clothing, we provide medical and dental care, not health insurance, but care to them, and that's through help with community volunteers who donate their time to provide the free medical care and dental care. We help women do their resume. We help them with job leads. We give bus passes.
We've got educational resources and help a lot of the women to get back into school.
Very good.
To further their education.
So you've been with the program since 2009. How long has this been in operation?
We opened the first home, well, we started in ATN in 2002. We opened our first home in 2003. We had one home. And, you know, some of the women who've left since then are still involved with our agency.
That's a long time. Now, yeah. When you say we started it, who was with you when at the beginning?
Well, other advocates and colleagues that I met along the way in doing this work. You know, I've been a legal advocate. I've worked in governor's offices. I've worked in police departments and met lots of people who want to make a difference. And I certainly knew that I wanted to make a difference based on the experience that I went through. And I had three kids, and I thought, my kids are not going to go through this.
Very good. It sounds like you have navigated social human services from a lot of different angles.
Yeah.
So apart, you mentioned a few of the supportive services. You mentioned dental. You mentioned certainly some on-the-job training skills. Mm-hmm. What else are examples of some of the programs or services that SEEDS offers?
Well, we do a lot of training and education in the community. We've done human trafficking training for the library staff and some City of Chandler staff as well. Our training has actually taken us to Europe. We've trained police, we've trained court staff. So we do a lot of training and public education around domestic violence, sexual abuse, and human trafficking and substance abuse.
And Judy, it sounds like, you know, the brief snippets of your story mm-hmm. that you've shared is that you found more than just wholeness, you found a mission that you've also engaged in.
Exactly.
With this.
Exactly. I was so impacted by the program and what the program did for me. I felt a very strong loyalty and a desire to help the women that came from where I came from. And my greatest pleasure is to watch those women move on from our program into leading independent lives successfully.
So since 2002, how many women have gone through your program, roughly? Roughly.
Wow.
I'd say probably, because now we have four homes, I'd say probably almost 1,000 women.
Wow, that's a big number. And how many is capacity at your homes now, if they were all full with your beds?
Well, two homes are for women with no children, two homes are for women with children.
Sure.
So the women with children basically have their own room. They don't have a whole apartment or anything. And so I'd say at any one time we could house 36 women and 8 kids.
Eight.
That's a significant number of people. Mm-hmm. Do you find your places usually at capacity, or how does that work?
We get anywhere between 5 and 12 requests for women that want to come into our program. We have a waiting list.
Okay.
And even though women can stay for 2 years, it doesn't mean they do. So depending on their family support and different other supportive systems that they have in place, some only stay with us short periods of time, where others stay long periods of time. So, but that is what we do, is a waiting list. I mean, we just had a Child Protective Services come over to the house because they just want to make sure the house is good environment for the kids. And they said to the woman, "How did you find out about this program? We want to put more women in here." You know, we really try to surround each and every woman with all the resources they need, mm-hmm. rather than a Band-Aid approach.
Sure.
And just, you know, a bed for the night or something, just that long term.
So how do people find out about it? Is it referrals from police departments, or how, if there is a battered woman or a woman in distress, how would she find out about your programs?
Well, most of the hotline numbers have our number. Okay. Police departments do. A lot of agencies
So 211 have our number. Definitely.
We don't spend any money on marketing, to be honest with you.
Okay.
We get a lot of referrals from other women also.
Mm-hmm. You know, word of mouth.
Word of mouth. And we do a prison outreach.
Excellent.
Also.
And how did you connect?
Well, I was in a situation, a domestic violence situation in Tucson, and I was fleeing a stalker and an abusive man, and I came into the, I found out about the program through a treatment center. And from the treatment center, I went into the SEEDS program and just kind of stayed there.
In fact, when she called, she said, well, I don't think I want to stay long. Mm-hmm. I think I only want to stay for a few weeks or a few months tops. And, you know, she stayed a while. And now she's on her own, of course, and she's a full-time employee with us.
Oh, very good. So you have full-time employees, and you also mentioned that there are opportunities for people to volunteer. You mentioned matching. So what are the opportunities for people to get involved, either at the coffee house or with the National Advocacy and Training Network?
Well, if anybody's interested in learning barista-type skills, we certainly need them at our coffee shops. We ask for a 4 to 6 hour shift once a week. But like I said earlier, it's mentoring the women and providing leadership skills as well to these teenagers and, you know, both men, women, and kids. And so that's really helpful. We've had community volunteers come over and teach the women how to make jewelry, and they sell them in the shop. We've had people come to our homes and teach the women how to cook certain meals or so what are some of the other things, doing crafts, and so we can always use volunteers.
So annually, through my nonprofit for our city, we work with the city of Chandler to highlight Chandler's top volunteers. So I expect to see some submissions from Cup of Karma for you once we start this process again in October or November to nominate maybe one of your top volunteers or a unique volunteer. And maybe we can bring some attention to them as well as the rest of Chandler's top volunteers as well. So people can volunteer. You have employees. How, if people wanted to support monetarily the organization, how would they do that?
Well, they could either call us or look on our website, and we have different tabs. There is a downloadable volunteer application. If they wanted to donate money, they could. There's a donate tab, and they could, you know, donate. You know, we ask anything from $5 a month. Every little bit helps.
And I think we're going to post that on here, but why don't you tell us your website, your social media sites, and tell us what they are.
Well, we have, our website is www.natn-az.org. Okay. And our we have a Facebook page as well. So it's www.facebook.com/CupOkarma.
All right. So if someone has a Facebook account, if they just type in CupOkarma, they will find it.
They'll find it. And we also have one, it's /NoMoreViolence, and that we post a lot of just educational type materials about domestic violence, sexual abuse, and human trafficking.
And you also mentioned that you're on our domestic violence council with the city. Do you want to give a shout out for anything that's coming up in the near future as well?
Well, we're looking forward to planning a domestic violence breakfast, which is growing by leaps and bounds every year. And that's going to be coming up in October, but it's we're going to be planning it up until then. And, of course, the commission meetings are always open to public members as well.
So is there any other resources for victims of domestic violence in our remaining minutes that you would like to draw to our audience to or to make known?
Well, the City of Chandler Police Department has had for quite some time the Victim Services Program, you know, within, and they're a great bunch of advocates. And you don't have to necessarily call the police to access their information. You can call and talk to them or access the website for more information about them. And then, of course, there's a 1-800-799-SAFE, which is 7233, for anybody who wants more information about domestic violence.
Very good. Well, in our remaining minute or two, Judy, do you have a favorite just snippet or window when at times you wonder, why am I doing this? Does it bring you back to someone that you helped or would you like to share with us?
I never have gotten tired of doing the work. And my job, I work with the women from the time that they reach out for help and come into the program until the time that they leave. So I get to follow these women's progress. The hardest part of my job is if a woman leaves our program and chooses to go back with her abuser. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the hardest time. That's sometimes when I wonder, am I making a difference? You know, does it make any difference what I do? And when I look at all of our success stories and all the women that have made it, I know that what I do makes a difference. And that's why I keep doing it.
Well, it sounds like you have an awesome program, and it's been a pleasure to listen to more of your story today. And thank you for what you do to our community and the lives that you have helped and saved and redirected and brought value to. And I want to thank you for watching us today. Again, I'm Vice Mayor Kevin Hartke, and you're watching Chandler in Focus. See you next time.